Hey, listen, pal. I didn't even have a Christmas this year, okay? No, not all of us are Ryan Shapp in a great tree mug.
There's White Claw in this tree mug.
Oh my god, dude, it's a Monday. Drink some fucking water. God, you god, have some respect for yourself. Oh my god, dude.
We get a lot of shots. Everybody comes to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks in the net.
I'm about to listen to Pucks on Net.
We used to talk about in Vancouver getting pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
This is JT Miller with the Vancouver Canucks, and you're listening to Pucks on Net.
Pucks on net and driving it, making a hard night on it.
Live on tape from a myriad of locations for the first time in 2022. This is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast that doesn't talk about fantasy, but more than likely will talk about fancy stats. Another satellite hot stove edition of the podcast coming at you. Coming to you from the living above the remnants of the old haunted Burger King. My name is Ryan Shapp. I'm going to be your host for the evening and eventually your blackjack dealer, as we'll get into in a bit. We head north over the Ironworkers Memorial Bridge, where Gita and the House of Greed had successfully put in their vacation request form. Very famously, you remember Arash's vacation request form was denied on the podcast, but Gita filled it out properly. So if we head to the village of Deep Cove, the Prince of Pomegranate, Mr. Arash Mamarzadeh. Arash, it's great to see you again in podcast form. How are you doing?
We saw each other like 3 days ago.
Oh, we saw each other a lot over the podcast and the Christmas break.
We did. And New Year's Eve, we watched Point Break.
Great movie.
Oh, yeah. It's the two things that you and Amanda love, and you never watch Point Break.
What's the second thing?
Surfing and action. There's two things. Ryan loves action. Yeah. Amanda loves surfing.
Hollywood blockbusters that just keep going and going until they won't stop.
Yeah. It's like me and Katie with The Terminal. You know that Tom Hanks movie? Katie loves Tom Hanks, and I love the fantasy of being stuck in an airport for like a month.
Well,
just living
mean,
there, you know? Like, what are you going to do? You know, you can't kick me out. I'm there for a reason. And then I'm, like, making friends with everyone. And, like, oh, my God, let me tell you. There's that one scene where they're going, he goes around and he tries to make money. So he goes and he gets, like, all the remaining carts. And every time he brings back a cart, he gets a quarter back. And then so he goes around getting, like, a stack. He gets, like, 20 carts in a row. And he gets enough change to go to a Burger King and get like a full meal. I don't know. Maybe it's the submissive in me, but I would love that to be my life. To be like, your only job is to get quarters, put it in a thing, get a bunch of money, go get a Whopper meal, and go sleep in like any of the gates at the airport.
They got Beyond Whoppers now. They have Impossible Whoppers.
You know, so you're
golden.
I tried it. It's not that great.
Yeah, I don't think
not
so.
Not that good, pal.
I would like to, personally, before we get into the show, I would like to thank the Vancouver Canucks for going 3-for-3 with our, working with us in our podcast schedule. When Big Monday show's coming up, they let go of all the guys on the Sunday. When we're taking our Christmas break, that's when all hell breaks loose and they, you know, they cut things off till at least the 28th. And now when it comes time to our first podcast of 2022, they're off for a whole week. This podcast is going to be fresh and tight till Saturday evening, Arash. It's everything we could hope for.
Well, yeah, or the Ottawa Senators get another game delayed. And then we're just wondering like, oh, so... when are we making up all these games? Oh, February?
Wait a minute. We've seen this before.
Wait a minute. February. What if this whole really contagious wave but mild symptoms for vaccinated people thing keeps going?
These are questions that we don't have answers for.
Nah, but they got to make it up as they go along at this point. I get it. They can't just like stop.
Everybody's making it up as they go along.
Yeah,
and
Doug Ford is. Do you see Doug Ford today?
He's making it up as he goes along. And we are here to distract the listeners from the Premier of Ontario.
Now remember, everyone, I gave you a dollar a beer. So, you know, who's the real criminal here?
So take the kids out of school.
So take the kids out of school. And 50% for retail because they need to stay open. But everyone else, you're closed. Okay. we had a long time to figure this out. Watch BC, just Bonnie Henry come out and be like, everyone needs to stay calm and kind. And also, you can go to a Walmart. It'll be full capacity. But independent businesses will be closed for the foreseeable future. But shop at a Walmart, distanced and kind with your friends. You know, like...
full capacity at Vancouver Canucks games as the community needs it. But the mask mandate will be in effect, right, Rogers Arena?
Yeah, yes, I see that the security and police officers at Rogers Arena are very strict on people's mask mandates. We enforce it very much. And also, Arash is the greatest white man ever. And you know, like who
she said that? Wow, what a quote!
Yeah, no, she's.
I don't know how to take that.
It's something. Man, it's a tough job to have. You got to respect people in that position because they literally at this stage, anything they do is going to be extremely questioned, and it's really tough. But also.
Hey, we're here to distract you. Well, and thank everybody for joining us wherever you got us from. Make sure you follow us on Twitter at pucksonetca or pucksonetca. And if you want to support, if you want to buy the naming rights of the PON ca for sometime in 2022, you'd head on over to patreon.com/pucksonet where you can pledge a couple of bucks.
Couple of dollar beers.
Couple of dollar beers, $5 beers. Well, it's like $7 Canadian dollar beers. That gives you instant access to all our bonus content. 5 minutes for paying. With the NHL shutdown and things kind of being haywire, we had to kind of push back. We had to punt our gambling episode, but that is coming up this month for sure.
You degenerate.
And you're like my co-host. Listen, I was on a heater in December. It would have been unfair to Arash. And if you want video,
you bet your life savings against the Harlem Globetrotters. I thought the Generals were due.
Using freaking ladder.
He's using a ladder, for Christ's sakes. He's just spinning the ball on his finger. Take it. Just take it.
If you want to listen to that eventual bonus episode, our 5 minutes for paying, watch this in video podcast in stunning, slight high definition, and just help support the show. You can head on over to patreon.com/pucksonet, $5 a month. We have a new backer this month who I believe is a return backer, hopping back on the old PON freight train. Grace M at 12:04 a.m. on New Year's Day.
That's
pledged
insane.
$5. So, want to thank you, and Grace. You're very smart because you get charged as soon as you become a Patreon backer. So you're getting the absolute most bang for your buck by hitting four minutes into the month. So you're smart. You're much smarter than us. And all you listeners out there that are thinking, listen, we're only 3 days in. Hop on board. I know you got New Year's resolutions. I'm not drinking any beer in January. You can support the damn show on Patreon.
Yeah, right. Wait. Did
I said
you,
beer.
Yeah. Did you say you're not drinking any beer?
That's my one goal.
Okay, what's in the cup that you're drinking right now?
That's a White Claw.
What are you doing?
It's a calorie thing. It's a calorie thing.
Oh, my God. Trumpian dissonance. I'm not drinking. Not drinking beer. I'm not going to get drunk. Like, get out of here, man.
Listen, we've all witnessed Arash show up at your apartment unannounced after a sushi dinner and drinking one really big beer and being a little too hot for prime time, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah,
so.
Sorry that I'm a little lightweight and I get a little funny. So, you know, as any white male would say, fuck me for caring.
And before we go any further, I got a hell of a birthday present and a podcast present from dear friend of the show, Yerky21, who's got a lot of time on his hands now that he doesn't have a comic to write, which I do fully intend on paying good hard-earned Canadian shekels for his Betting on Empty hardcover.
Oh, I am absolutely buying that coffee table book.
Well, when he sends his custom Pucksonet playing cards...
Amazing.
You know... Where is it? There we go. That's an ace. Who cares about that? You know, oh, I'm butchering this. When he sends his playing cards, you know, perfect for gambling for any occasion, you know, featuring our mugs and a hell of a creative effort. We can't thank them enough. So again, and also want to thank Heather Smart. She sent us a lovely Christmas card over the holiday break.
Heather, that was so sweet. Thank you.
And we just want to thank everybody for listening and sticking with us. The calendar year's turned over. Bruce, there it is, baby. It's 2022, and it's time to talk about...
How about we just keep it to a Bruce, there it is? You know. Let's just...
That, it was so perfect. I couldn't tell you how hard I laughed at that tweet. It just, and you read it in that C-ball voice. But Canucks win. Let's just keep it to a Bruce, there it is. All right?
Yeah, let's just... All right. All right. Yeah, I'm just at a disbelief that we're at January 1st or whatever. They are one game above 500. That's insane to me. Like, yeah. I can't believe, like, I thought, oh, okay, you know, if they make a run, you know, it's probably going to take till February. We'll see. Maybe they're doing an incremental thing, but like, you look at Edmonton, they are floundering. You look at Anaheim, they're
back to earth.
Back to earth. San Jose, the Kings. Do the Avalanche have 7 games in hand? Yes. But
wait, we don't talk about the Colorado Avalanche until it's too late.
The
Colorado Avalanche.
I've just kind of been marveling at the fact that, you know, they've went on the stretch run, and they've been playing. I mean, you just look at certain players like Tyler Myers, and I'm a Tyler Myers truther. I love the man to death, but like,
he's on the ban. Criticism is still on the ban list.
Yeah, it's just like, you know, you look at him and he's like playing. He's playing that, you know, that effective, like at least in a top four kind of situation, Yeah, JT Miller is on a completely different level. He's making passes that only I can make in NHL and not Ryan, because Ryan doesn't know how the R1 button works. And it's just been crazy. I think the one frustrating thing is like, fuck, like they're going on this run and they're getting this kind of momentum, but again, COVID and stoppages and delayed games are getting in the way. And you look at someone like Jim Rutherford and you have to think like, okay, you know, how much more patient is this man going to be when he has very clearly shown that, you know, he can wait a little bit, but he can't wait forever.
Well, he's shown that patience or lack thereof when he was in win now mode with two of the best players of their generation. And you got to imagine, as much as we expect Trader Jim to show his, put on that, you know, that translucent visor and make some deals, start cutting deals with Tanner Pearson going anywhere. I'm not too nervous on him getting impatient and making a big deal. You know, the good Branson deals, the Jack Johnson deals. I'm optimistic, but again, it's what is this team and where is this team going to be come the deadline? What kind of playoff spot this is in? Just because a handful of the Pacific Division teams are floundering and the Canucks are still coming up, we could be having a completely different discussion after their Eastern Conference road swing, where they play an 8-headed monster one night after another, where you really see what Thatcher Demko can do and how many holes are in the Canucks defense. Like, it's all well and good right now, but like, I would say, you know, the determining factor of who stays or who goes is coming up this month in January.
I think the most reassuring thing, and I hope that people, again, that have followed this team for the last 8 years, see the absolute difference between having someone that, you know, in Jim Benning, where I'm, again, probably very nice human being. It's probably very well liked by hockey personnel, but is not the most charismatic person behind a microphone, and not the most clear and concise person in terms of understanding how to send a message. Jim Rutherford, I mean, it's crazy because in every radio hit and interview, like he had a thing with Patrick Johnson today.
Oh, really?
It's been the same message being delivered. We're not trading our first. If we're getting stuff back, it's young players and picks. Because we need to insulate the trajectory that everyone hits at a peak and everyone hits at a point. And then at that point, you know, obviously that's when you solidify trading picks to insulate and then go and go for a run. Now his, talking just strictly about the positives, like, okay, so they're on this at this run. He has some really big questions in front of him in terms of moves coming up. So, yeah, you look at Tanner Pearson, you look at...
Well, he's already gone.
I don't know. I mean, Tanner Pearson...
For the sake of the joke, as soon as Jim Rutherford walked in, Tanner Pearson
walked because he traded Tanner Pearson before. And he's like, hey, pal, good to see you again, eh? Just wondering how you like North Carolina.
Hey, he's out there getting Gordie Howe hat tricks. I mean, that's just what North Kakalaki needs.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, he just has a couple of questions in terms of, A, how can he consolidate and create the cap space? How can he generate assets in the vision that he wants to go forward and do that to? So he's not going to trade picks to get out of the Tucker Pullman deal for, I mean, Jesus Christ, that deal at 2.5 for 4 years is just looking like doof the doy.
Well, what about the Jason Dickinson deal? You brought that up. You brought that up like, oh, he's, you know, and all the best to him. We're not here to kick a guy when he's down, when he's out on the COVID protocol. But like, this is a guy that was supposed to be brought in to be a bottom six specialist. Hell, he was supposed to be brought in to be a third line center.
I think.
And you look and like, I did 30 seconds of research. I'm like, oh, what was his face-off percentage in Dallas?
He's not
never near 50.
So it was this misunderstood idea that Jason Dickinson was this Manny Malhotra-esque third line center option, because in the offseason, you know, everyone, all the media were talking about, oh my God, look at his suppression metrics. Mm-hmm. Oh, he's an amazing defensive forward. Like, okay, great. But let's maybe not look so far into analytics and just look at some basic numbers. One of them being his offensive peak was what, 20, 25 points so far in his career. Second, he is not a natural face-off centerman.
No.
So now you have a player that is a bona fide bottom six winger whom offensively is stinting, but though is not so much a defensive liability. Is more of like a specialist, like a five-on-five or even a penalty-killing specialist. But again, you're paying for that in a 3-year term at 2.65.
Yeah.
So you, Jim Rutherford, looking and saying, okay, what are some things that I could do? Yes, Jason Dickinson is that, because if you lose Jason Dickinson, you know, is that a, you have to, Jim Rutherford is probably asking, okay, if we do lose Jason, is that a huge blow to this roster right now? He has 6 points in what, 31 games?
I think he has 4 points. I think 2 goals. He has 2 goals and under 5 assists. I know that.
Yeah, I think it might be kind of in that ballpark.
And with a player like that, you're not supposed to look at his, you know, this is where the Jay Fresh wormhole comes in, your natural stat trick wormhole comes in for a player like Dickinson. But even then,
you're just paying a premium. You're paying that player in the way that this roster is constructed to slot into your third line center position. And sadly, when you sign a player to fill in a hole that oddly enough ends up filling another hole that you have, but for too much money, that's where the imbalance comes in. Because now you're out looking for a third line center again. And you look at this roster and, you know, at least Bruce, you know, has run Horvat, Miller, Pedersen. Pedersen is another thing that we have to get to. I'm just really curious once Jim Rutherford goes and he fills out the general manager spot, what the next course of action is, because he sure as hell has not come out and said, oh, you know, we're going for it. And he said, yeah, we're going. He has come out clear as day saying, yep, we have a good run. I'm not going to take anything out of the fact that these guys have come back from that deficit in their record. It's great, but we need to be realistic here. You know, we need to keep a level head and understand that this roster or this accumulation of assets by this organization is not where it needs to be. And
it sounds like the conversation or the dialogue that you wanted Jim Benning to have after the 2014-2015 season, where they made the playoffs, played six extra games that year, and then went, well, shit, this team's pretty good. We don't need to do anything. Let's make a little better. Let's spend a little money. Let's make some deals.
Yeah, that's what mirages do, man. it's really bad when business is mixed with stuff like this. And, you know, we came back and we looked at Francesco coming out and saying that maybe he should have done things earlier. Yeah, we're talking years, not days, Francesco. But okay, you know what? The one life lesson that I've really taken out of the 32 years that I've been on this earth is, it's better to have just learned the lesson at a point than never to have learned it at all.
Of course.
And we can be angry that it took until, you know, 8:15 and 2 in December of 2021. But, you know, here we are, and for all the issues that people might have with Jim, or I think it's a PTSD thing where they think that Jim Rutherford's going to come in and we're going to be trading for like Alex Killorn or, you know, like some, you know, Sam Gagner is going to come back. You know, Michael Delzato is going to get picked off of waivers because we need a DJ, and these damn kid Niels Höglander's playing Fortnite too much.
Arash, four syllables. Patrick Maroon at a premium.
I don't know if Tampa will ever give him up. That's a three. that man's won like 16 consecutive Stanley Cup championships in a row. I'm just Ryan, you know what? Okay, I've really wanted to talk to someone about this because it's really hard to also balance this because I want to be very positive about this team, and I think we should. They have played outrageously well. But it's something that I've wrapped my head around, and Twitter seems to be kind of on the fence about.
Well, let's leave Twitter out of it, because if I think I know where you're going down a little EP40 rabbit hole.
It's the two. Listen. Okay. Can we go on? Can I go on this?
Let me just have a swig of water here.
Have
pal.
A swig of your White Claw. There you go. Drink it down, buddy. We'll both. There you go. All right, Ryan Schaap. I think the one thing that a lot of people sometimes don't fully understand in hockey is a very specific business type mentality to come to it at, where you need to accumulate at, you need to take away player bias sometimes. And you need to understand, how do I accumulate the most amount of assets in a system where there are 31 other teams also not only trying to accumulate assets, but also every team is given a specific amount. So if that's draft picks, players on a roster, whatever. And your job is to take what you are given at any specific window of time and accumulate that, and then reach a peak, and then hopefully you can compete in a way that other teams aren't prepared to kind of meet you at.
Also, toss in the fact that most of the teams in the league right now have cap issues regardless, and anything that's going to be moved is cash in, cash out.
Yep.
100%. All the time.
So there was this one debate that has been rip-roaring, and where it's about JT Miller.
Oh.
Ryan, I have a question for you. Has JT Miller given you any inclination or any feeling than the offseason of 2023, he is wanting to take a kind of question hometown, a little bit of a discount on a longer-term deal until he's 35 to 36 potentially with the Vancouver Canucks. His attitude, like, I'm not saying he's had a tremendously bad attitude or anything, not saying that, but I'm saying from looking at the trajectory of his career from New York to Tampa to now, where he's wanted to compete. He got traded from Tampa immediately before they won two straight Stanley Cups. He came here, made the bubble, did the bubble, had the horrific COVID season, missed, you know, and all this stuff. And yeah, he's a competitor and whatever. He's going to be a 30-year-old. And are you really expecting JT Miller at that point?
I don't
expect in terms of just odds of him re-signing with the Vancouver Canucks. And not only that, are you willing to sign a UFA forward at 30 years of age to a 5 to 6 year deal?
With what is on the work that's on the table right now for whoever is going to be GM, for the contracts they have to deal with and navigate through and re-sign. I feel like with JT Miller, any conversation about him right now, it's nothing personal. It's 100% under the business side of, it's under the business umbrella of this game.
Mm-hmm.
Where he's gone, how he's performed, do I expect him to take some sort of sweetheart deal, a 4 or 5 year deal to stay with the Canucks and maybe be the contender? Not necessarily, because I look at it right now where he's got one of the better deals. Look at a point a game guy making under $5 million. There's so many contending teams that could benefit from that.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's making 5.275, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. He's making a little bit north of five.
And you brought it up before the Christmas break, and I look at him like the way Jim Rutherford looked at the real deal James Neal. And it's just like, this is a guy that's having a good stretch of years, but how is that going to look? What's he going to look like in 4 years? And hell, he cleared waivers this week. Like,
let's not totally throw James Neal under the bus. I mean, he went out after Pittsburgh to Nashville, had good years, also had a good year in
Vegas as a specialist.
Yeah,
goes to Calgary, doesn't fit in. Goes to Edmonton, doesn't fit in. I'm not saying they're comparable players in the least, but I'm just like, you notice some similarities in their career trajectory, and I'm not completely sold on JT Miller long term. In a way that I'm looking at how the Canucks can improve themselves now,
yeah,
what they can do with JT Miller now. And we've had 8 years of front office that looks at tomorrow, or they're not looking 7 years down the road when they trade for Louis Eriksson, or they trade for Oliver Ekman-Larsson. And if there is a deal to be made that's going to make this team leaps and bounds better, it's going to be a big loss for sure, but you gotta look at the dollars and cents. It's a business move, and if they can find something, if they can trade him to, I don't know, a Toronto or somebody with money and get a hell of a return, you gotta do it.
My mentality is that you have to be really able to make some very hard decisions. In saying there are 4 to 5 players at this bar, that is, we only have five. We can't say, oh, well, we have 8 core players. No, you need to say, okay, we need to make a really hard decision and say the 5 core pieces we have, let's say Thatcher Demko, Quinn Hughes, Elias Pettersson, Brock Besser, and of course, Tucker Pullman. And so, no shade on Tucker Pullman. He's in the show where we have a hockey podcast. So, you know, you have to, maybe Bo Horvat at this stage in terms of age and cap sits at that position.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, you probably put JT Miller in that core position now, today, right now. But in 2 to 3 years from now, is he going to, in the time that you're hitting that peak, is he going to be the player that he is today? Has he, maybe he regresses a little bit. He's not going to completely fall off the cliff. But these are the kind of tough questions that you really need to ask. And it's a very polarizing thing because a lot of people will get, I don't know, this like visceral reaction. Like, how can you trade? He's a heart and soul guy. How can you do that? It's like, yeah, you need to. These are decisions that make championships. Yeah, these are decisions that make championship rosters and championship teams in terms of being able to look at something in a business mentality and thinking, okay, if I trade JT Miller right now, he has 2 years remaining, shy north of five, to a contending team. They are getting him for two playoff runs. Massive. Massive. Yeah. It's not a rental price. This is you have control on this player. You are getting, you know, a first, a prospect, and a young player, a young roster player.
You're getting a lot.
You think about how you can fit, you can trade one thing to potentially fix three holes. One of them being, do you go out and get a young right-handed shot defenseman? Do you go and get a prospect that's a little bit down the line that you like? Do you accumulate another first to use in whatever way you kind of seem, you know, you want to use it? Do you want to use it as draft capital, or do you want to use it as trade bait? Whatever, you know, whatever you want to give you flexibility. And then also you get that cap space back. So it's just these, like, I hope that when people, you know, you're hearing the suggestion about having a discussion about trading specific players, like Pettersson is a different one. Pettersson is a
that's not even a discussion. Even if you needed to trade him, the dumbest possible time is to trade him right now, where he's not having his best stretch.
You have control on Elias Pettersson, and I also do need to remind people, like, guys, go look up Nathan McKinnon's first few years in the show.
Oh yeah,
I think people forget this. I think people think that Nathan McKinnon has always been this like baseline 80-point scorer. Go look up his first season, pretty great debut season. Look at the 2 to 3 consecutive seasons after that.
55-point guy, you know, afterthought on Team North America, you know, the young gun team in the World Cup, which needs to return, as we'll discuss a bit later. But, like, yeah, you don't – he's young as hell. He's, you know, dealing with the – he's learning how to be a pro in a pandemic. He's dealing with a coaching change. He just dealt with a tough love, less minutes, prove me wrong kind of coach. He's figuring it out with a guy that's given him all the time in the world, giving him all the opportunities and working with them. Now, like, again, it's December. This feels like this has been about a 4 year season.
Yeah, I feel.
But it's December. Well, it's January. Well, never mind.
Dude, who cares? Time has no meaning. What are we doing?
It's not the time. And even if it was the time, you don't trade a player like that in a slump like this, and it's just you don't when you have, especially if it's a JT. I'm not even entertaining the thought.
There's
but if two, it's a, you trade JT Miller.
There's
you
two, trade JT okay, so Miller. Just to differentiate between these two, because these are two different moves. Yeah. If you're looking at, I'm just gonna go for it, and if people fucking hate me for it, I'm just gonna whatever.
Send hate tweets to at Arash Mamarzadeh.
We need to have these are discussions we need to have, so we're gonna have them, guys, because we need to have these.
You know what it is, Arash? You need to have these difficult but very reasonable discussions, because the last guys that worked here didn't seem to have them.
No, I don't think they understood the idea of what a discussion was. They wanted autonomy and having a collaborative discussion. And, like, you know, I had 4 years of performing arts training. And the one thing in my fourth year, we did a collaborative thing where, again, kind of an unmitigated disaster, but it was like 22 of us were all the directors of a show.
Oh, God.
And I'm like, it made me love, like, dictatorship. It's really weird. I was like, man, I really just want one person to be in charge, or one person to be like, yes, no. But
it makes
having...
you appreciate somebody that's confident in their decision making.
Yeah, but also
that can benefit everybody.
Yeah, but and it's also just the idea of like having someone. I would love having someone in the room that is able to make the decision, but before they do, they listen to the other 21 people and then they make the decision. Mm-hmm. And as opposed to the other way around, where it's like, you know, you're never going to get it done. Anyway, the moves involving one. Okay, so JT Miller and Bo Horvat. Again, love Bo, but what indication has he fully given you that if they do not turn this around, that come up when he's a UFA in 2023, he's going to be like, yeah, sign me up again. I'm 28. Let's go. And he, you know, that's what I think people need to understand. This isn't an idea of if we offer them a contract, they will sign it because they're being offered a contract and we'll sign them. Mm-hmm. That isn't how this works. So you look at JT, you look at Bo, and you can...
Short names.
Short names. Big players, short names. Really, really, really good names. And you look at the assets that you can get back and not have to worry about re-signing them in 2023 if you can re-sign them.
Mm-hmm.
Because if they in their minds, depending on what happens this year and next year, if they have put in their minds, when I'm testing UFA, I'm going into the UFA waters.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can do. You can't go to the NHLPA and file a grievance. Like, hey, no, Bo Horvat's ours. He can't go sign anywhere. No, you can't do that. So that's a hard decision that you have to make, that if you seriously explained it, majority mm-hmm. of the people in this market would understand, because the last thing people want is for the last 8 years to happen again. Now, Elias Pettersson is different because you have control.
Mm-hmm.
So the same thing about going to the NHLPA and filing a grievance. You control him as an RFA. And you have time in the next 3 years to see where where his trajectory kind of climbs to. Before the 3 years is up, he has one more year as a UFA. And from there, that's when you make the decision. That's where you're like, okay, well, this player is obviously either surpasses our expectations or isn't what we exactly needed him to be. So we can move on from this. So Elias Pettersson is not a decision you have to make now. The other glaring one that we've discussed is Brock Besser, strictly due to the fact that Ryan,
he's got to go.
I love Brock. You love Brock. Mm-hmm. Are you paying him north of $8 million?
Absolutely not.
And are you doing that on a long-term deal?
No.
Okay, so you're not doing that on a long-term deal. Are you doing that on a 1 year? Because if you do that, if you qualify him, he's a UFA.
I don't want to do that either.
So you're screwed. So, like,
these are the tough
decisions
you got to do.
These are tough decisions that you need to just you just need to understand why people are thinking about making them, because that's how you get better. This is how you get better. You do not get better in a capitalist business by not at least thinking of red paper clipping. Like, it's a very simple idea. You have mm-hmm. an asset, you trade it for another thing, until you grow and grow and grow and you have a house. And you wonder, how the hell did I do that? It's like, it's supply, demand, want, need, time, expectation, leverage, desperation, whatever. Taking all these things into consideration, making mm-hmm. really hard choices. And I love the run that they've gone on right now. I love it. Didn't talk to you about it, but like my parents, holy shit, Ryan.
Yeah.
My parents, I sat down with my folks watching a game, with one of the Bruce There It Is games. Keep it to a, how about we keep it to a Bruce There It Is. And they're just invigoration. My dad's 74. My mom is just reaching her 70s.
Yeah.
Their reinvigoration brought so much energy to me to get onto Twitter, engage even more, be happy that I'm part of this. And I think I've reached a point as an adult, and I think our listeners also have reached a point in their lives where they've dealt with a lot of shit for the last 8 years. And if they have to make really difficult decisions, this fan base will understand. But the fan base needs to also just broaden their mind. Like, I always talk about, sorry I'm ranting, but I'm a little fired up. There's one thing I've really noticed. Mm-hmm. Is some people have a critical inability to think past the one very thin line of film that is created when you boil milk. Like, they cannot think of the entire pot of milk below it, and they can't have any depth level of thinking outside me, like JT Miller. JT Miller offer contract, he signed this NHL 22. They can't understand that. Look at the history. Look at him hunching over the net in the bubble. Look at him having to come out and back up this team when they are riddled with COVID, when the organization wouldn't.
Yeah.
If you think for a second that stuff does not have an effect on a person's mind going into a decision where 31, like after you break, potentially are breaking up with someone, and they're asking you to come back, and you're looking at the 31 other hinge matches that might look a little, oh my God, this guy makes his own pasta noodles? Oh, that's kind
of
cool.
31 people, each of them offering you just a little bit something different, something and a little different, bit more.
Just something different, right? And you just have to look at it in that way. So before you get to that point where you're the only thing you have left is hope that they come back to you, like, you hope that in the sit down with their family and their agent that Vancouver is the choice at that point, you have to be proactive. Yeah. You have to take the initiative into your hands and act on it. And I just really hope that that the stuff that Jim Rutherford has said in terms of accumulating draft picks, getting younger players in, that's where they need to go. And I hope that these discussions about these certain players are being had right now.
I think that people look at the Canucks and, like, it's easy to look at the Leafs. It's like, well, they had four guys that they had to sign no matter what. I don't say that. The Canucks don't have four incredibly dynamic goal scoring offensive threats that are just, you know, tops in the league. They have two. A funny thing you keep hearing is any media availabilities, any comments in the media, it's about two guys. It's Thatcher Demko and it's Quinn Hughes. And we love this team, but I'm starting to get the sense that a lot of it is expendable if you need to make the best possible move. Now, we're not saying they're going to move everybody, but, like, outside of 43 and 35, there's something there.
Yeah, I don't think I you hit the nail. Right. And you know what? I'll be totally honest with you. I always say, you know, it's funny. I always say that. I'll be totally honest with you. Like, I'm going to say something really
I've been bullshitting on this podcast for the last year, but now I'm going
to
be serious.
Yeah. I have to check myself at that. You know, you look at the equation of Nils Höglander and Vasily Podkolzin at their age, of how they are producing and how they play. You really have to give them a little bit more respect in that we're talking about the window and the trajectory.
Yeah.
That they are gonna, they are now the crucial next pieces, strictly based off of, okay, now you can offer them a bridge. You know, you're not, Vasily Podkolzin, his next contract isn't going to be an 8x8, but you're going to give him, you know, a four or five year at four or whatever, yes, just to consolidate. Nils Höglander, kind of the same thing. That's where the value is created. It's not until their UFA years where you're not going to really exactly get value because you're paying market price because there's no control there. So you have to put a bit more respect on their names in terms of going forward. Like you said, everyone else, you just need to sit down and have a honest conversation as a business and as a management group and say, this is not about us not liking JT Miller as a player, not liking Bo Horvat as a captain, not liking Elias Pettersson as a cornerstone player, not liking Brock Besser as a point producing winger.
Yeah.
But just saying, like, if we want to get better and we want to get to the position that you look at Tampa, you look at other teams that have accumulated so many assets through their farm system. And
do you want to be Tampa or do you want to be the Calgary Flames?
I mean, hey, listen, Calgary's not doing too bad right now. Well, but that's Daryl. Daryl got in there, he threw out the Nintendo Wii in the locker room. He's like, get the shit out of here.
That was a last ditch effort from
Daryl.
He's
like, you want to play? I got some hay bales in the back, Johnny. Just go. Fine.
I got a whole bus of Sutter boys looking for help.
Yeah. I think this is a really well-deserved time for Canucks fans in that.
Yeah.
Listen, they're a game above 500. This is amazing. This is fantastic. But just like, I need to be careful here. Just like 2014 and 2015 was that mirage.
Yeah.
You have to respect Jim Rutherford for coming out and saying, this is great, the run that we've gone on. This is fantastic. But we have to be realistic and kind of know where we need to get better.
Yeah, there's no delusion there. It's you ask yourself the basic question: is this team a Stanley Cup contender? No.
No.
Well then, do you want it to be? Yes. So make the tough decisions now. Grow around these pieces that are legit cornerstones, and get there because. They made tough decisions in all the previous eras of the Canucks. And we've talked a lot about the tough decisions to be made. But, man, we barely touched on how fun this team is to watch right now.
Yes.
And it's been – I was thinking about it today that this team – the Canucks have not played this type of fun, exciting, compelling hockey since the West Coast Express era. And it's it's great to – it's just the fan base is on board. This is a fun it's simple hockey to watch. It makes sense and it's exciting and it's great, and we want to see this team. Well, they're never going to lose in regulation again, so
no,
we've accepted that.
Yeah, they're I mean, we obviously understand that we're going to lead the Pacific Division, and it depends on the third round who we get matched up with. Maybe that's when I'll start questioning things.
Arash, I do want to touch I want to head east a bit, because I have the Edmonton Oilers New York Rangers game on to my camera right. And, you know, the Oilers started out playing the most wild, successful stretch of hockey that we've seen in a long time.
Yeah.
And then they've absolutely come back to earth. So in terms of the two kind of hot stretches, you know, the Canucks are 8-0-1 and the Edmonton Oilers were going to score 900 goals and just be perfect. Like, are you more concerned about, is the Canucks streak, is it a little more concrete? Is a little more merit there than what you saw to start the Oilers season?
Can you specify a little bit?
Do you have, the Oilers have completely fallen off.
Yeah.
They're talking about coaching changes. They're talking about, trading a lot to bring assets
like,
in.
Are you asking whether the Edmonton Oilers are as, like, kind of bad as they are, as opposed to the Canucks being as good as they are right now?
Essentially, yeah.
I would be really wary as an Edmonton Oilers fan of what's happening there, strictly due to the fact that, like, listen, you have arguably the best player of our generation in Connor McDavid.
Mm-hmm.
You might run that man out of town just because he might just say, I've had enough.
Yeah.
Like, you... the weight of knowing that you're the best player in the world and the weight of knowing that you have not reached even a pinnacle. This isn't a Jay Bomeister situation where it's like, oh, he's like 31. He's never played in the playoffs. This is a person who might at the end of their career go down as, one of the top 5 to top 10 players of all time.
Yeah.
And you are riding this person out. And saying, okay, well, Cody Ceci, and we got Duncan Keith, and hey, Mikko Koskinen, we're running back Mikko Koskinen and Mike Smith, and Stuart.
Goals,
I mean, Stuart Skinner's
averages.
There too. Stuart Skinner's not too bad there, but again, like, every person has their breaking point.
Yeah,
and I would just be really wary because you know, with the Canucks, you know, the Canucks' breaking point right now is, listen, you know, Quinn signed that deal. Quinn is now on pace for 70 points to break the all-time Canucks points record pretty handedly. I think it's set at 63. I would just be really wary because you look at the Edmonton Oilers, they don't have a ton of assets. Like, what are they going to trade Nuge? And then do you trust Ken Holland to go out and get an asset for Nuge that would actually help? Like, he hasn't shown. He gave up assets to get Duncan Keith. Like, you know, so I would just be wary because you look at the Edmonton Oilers, and if one of Leon and Connor breaks, and that's the other tough part, is now you're not talking about just one person mentally breaking. You're talking about two people reaching their boiling point. One of two. They lose either of them. Like, listen, man.
And like, since December 1st, Oilers are 2-8-2. They're down 4-1 to the Rangers with 4 minutes to go. And like,
did you see that Mikko Koskinen goal tonight?
Which one? Because he's looking. I've watched he's full of holes. Everything's just trickling in.
It's so reminiscent. Like, this is if Roman Čechmánek was 6'6". You know, like, just giving, just crazy, crazy. And the crazy thing is, it seems like every Edmonton game, there is a goalie bumbling the puck behind the net for a goal type goal.
Yeah, the like, misplays of the month. It's just Edmonton Oilers goals against.
Yeah. And it's just, man, it's just crazy. It's crazy to think that you can have Leon Draisaitl and Connor McDavid and Darnell Nurse, and you can't, like, again, this is what we need. This is the same thing. You need to have these really difficult conversations in Edmonton where it's very clearly defined. Your top three players are McDavid, Draisaitl, Nurse. That is your core. Everyone else, if you have to wipe the slate clean of every single player on that roster outside of those three, you do it because you want to win. Here you go, man. You need to accumulate assets. You need cap flexibility to make smart, lasting deals. Like, Jim Rutherford, give credit to Jim Rutherford. Like, if he was in Edmonton. Like, I know the tail end of Pittsburgh was really tough because, you know, you look at Gudbranson and you look at Jack Johnson and Mike Matheson and whatever, you know, those are tough. Some of the moves he made knowing that he had Letang, Malkin, Crosby. He was okay letting go of Marc-Andre Fleury.
Those three guys had three expansion. Stanley Cups, too. Those were winners.
Yeah, those were winners. And then, you know, he goes out and he finds Chris Kunitz and he finds other auxiliary pieces and he kind of wraps everything together and Brian Dumoulin and all this stuff. It's, you know, Nick Bonino. What do you do, Bonino, pa? Bonino.
But Arash, you hit a good point there. It's like, you know, there's no, you have those three and that's what you invest in and then you make smart decisions around them. And meanwhile, whatever cap flexibility the Oilers had, that went out the window when they traded assets at, I think, full value for Duncan Keith.
Keith still has fucking... I'm sorry to interrupt. He still has term. Like, it's just crazy to me.
And then you make the tough decision that isn't necessarily the wrong decision, isn't a bad decision in getting Zach Hyman, but that's a lot of money to pay a guy that works really hard.
Term. That is a lot of term. Money, yeah. Okay, money's the one thing. Term. Whole, it's just like, okay, well, you know. These are just difficult decisions. Difficult discussions that I hope from our little rant here. I hope when people kind of engage with people on whatever social media platform, if it's, you know, Twitter,
Clubhouse.
HF boards, Clubhouse, whatever the Donald Trump social media thing is.
Parler,
yeah. If they're meeting Tony D'Angelo on Parler. You know, these are difficult decisions and just how to engage with them. So if someone, you know, says, oh, you know, we should think about trading this, it's not just like that skim of milk. it's just like, think one step further. Be like, oh, shit, okay.
Hey, you might be on something.
Time,
there.
Money, flexibility, peaking at a specific time. All of these things that, again, Jim Rutherford has talked about. And yeah. I'm just really excited, Ryan. I'm really excited because I'm like, he has a lot of things to fix. And he has a lot of things that he needs to get out of. And the man has... The one thing I can say about the NHL is when the NHL finds a man they love, like Jim Rutherford, like Jim Rutherford's Rolodex, baby, is deep. Oh. People remember Jimmy. They love Jimmy. They probably had a couple beers. Yeah, Jimmy, yeah.
Come to the coast, Jimmy.
Come to the coast, have a couple laughs. It'll be good. You know, I just imagine Jim Rutherford getting on the Rolodex being like, hey, pal. Well, how are you doing, pal? Oh, hell. You look at these games? Crazy. Man, hey, how's the kids doing? Yeah, good. You know, just this, like, thing. And then him just being like, man.
It's tough go. You know, I'm looking at your... Holland, I'm looking at your road trip here. Oh, it's tough. I'd like to help you out, though.
Holly,
we've had summers together.
Holly, you're having trouble there on the defense. You know, I'm losing sleep here, too. You know, I'm not too happy. I got this Tucker Pullman fella. You know, and then the other guy's like, oh, well, I like Jim. I like Fergie. Let me help you out because we're a family. This is the end. And that's the thing is that you've never seen an NHL general manager. Well, okay, I'm not going to say you've never because Kyle Dubas and Steve Yzerman kind of do this, but just like the idea of like treating it less as a clubhouse and more of like a brutal, like, I'm Iranian and I know how to haggle and I know you're white and you get nervous at the idea of asking for a discount. Like, using that leverage.
Of course.
My hottest take, Ryan, you want my hottest take ever, that a person of color will one day become a general manager of an NHL team and they will have a history of some of the biggest fleeces and deals strictly because, Ryan, old white men do not know how to haggle. And to this person, it'll be so natural, being like, I don't know why they accept first offer. What is this? What? I don't understand. What? Okay, fine. Maybe I try again. Let me pick up phone. It's like ring, ring. Hello. Okay, hey, listen. It's Connor McDavid guy. I do you favor, okay? It's the 12.5, lots of money, okay?
Big money.
Listen, I give you the Tanner Pearson, first round pick I got from JT Miller deal 5 minutes ago. I give you that for McDavid. Oh, you accept? Okay, hang up and be like, this motherfucker, he did it again. These people are crazy.
This is what's going to happen if or when Jim Rutherford selects Arash Marzadeh as general manager of your Vancouver Canucks.
God, I wish I was insanely wealthy. I would just buy like the Arizona Coyotes and just create the just hire like literally like, I don't care if you've never been to post secondary. Like if you grew up a brown person or whatever, and in what a brown male, female, whatever. If you
only
grew
two
up
genders?
Non-binary, male, female, whatever you need, just put them in a position, I swear to God they would slay. Just strictly based off of the whole, like, looking at your parents and learning haggling through them. Like your mom going to an IKEA and just refusing to pay sticker price. At an IKEA, and they're like, yeah, hello, mom, we do not do this type of deal. And your mom's like, well, I don't know how you stay in business. And you're just there eating a hot dog being like, mom, you're embarrassing me in front of other girls. My Swedish friends. Nils is there. Stop. You're embarrassing me in front of Nils.
I couldn't agree more. Let's do some quick house cleaning on the Canucks. Our pal, Bruce, there it is, Gabby. He ties the NHL record for the longest win streak to begin a tenure with a new team with 7 wins. Now he's undefeated in regulation, 8-0-1. Thatcher Demko was the third star of the month of December. Some guy named Austin Matthews and some guy named Patches were first and second, respectively. Thatcher Demko has a 7-0-1 record in December, a 1.72 goals against, and a 9.46 save percentage with one shutout. Somebody drew a comparison to a Jacob Markstrom's hot stretch.
That was I believe that was Tom Strands.
Yeah, 14-2. It was like 18-19 season. He had a 2.70 goals against and a 9.2. Thatcher Demko is, I absolutely love, and he should be in the discussion of, we got two guys that ain't going.
No, he absolutely is.
And it's incredible. I love it. They, last year, you kind of go, well, you know, they need a 1A, they need a 1B. And now it's like, no, we have a goalie.
Yeah, you have a goalie for four. Arguably, I think the greatest move Jim Benning ever made was, it's going to go down. Is the Thatcher Demko extension.
The fact that he's not making Sergei Bobrovsky money when in this window of difficult decisions.
Four more years at five. Crazy. Love insanity.
It. Yeah. Arash, did you get kicked off a plane for getting too drunk on duty-free liquor, trying to vape, and listening to music on your iPhone?
Yeah, Russian machine never break. These media, they want to tell you what happened at the airport. I tell you what happened at the airport, okay? We are there sitting, nice, listening to Tattoo, drinking Stoli. Then people say you cannot smoke, and we say it's been hard year. It's COVID, you know, seek the blood. And we want to have good time. They do not let us have good time. Putin call, he say, why you not let them have good time? Russian machine never break. What do you want me to say?
None of that also happened either.
None of that.
I went through a bit of a deep dive because the story just got wilder and wilder when you go through the replies, and it was like presidential elections. All the Russian bots coming out. That didn't happen. For the quick bit of housekeeping here, one of the kind of miserable things that happened was the World Juniors got canceled two days in, and we got snowed in Vancouver, and the Canucks all had COVID, and the NHL was shut down. So I was ready to study this Team Canada, study these games, because we had nothing else to do, and those got bounced. And trying to fly back to Russia on a flight from Calgary to Frankfurt, the Russian World Juniors got kicked off the plane. Police circled the plane, removed them because of, yeah, the coaches were in business class vaping and listening to music on their iPhone speaker.
Amazing.
Which
I mean, awful, like awful, but also,
you ever been drunk on an airplane? You're just getting fired up. Nothing else to do. You're stuck in your seat. Oof. And the boys in the back and coach were hacking darts. They weren't wearing masks. They were drinking duty-free liquor, which I'm always amazed that more people aren't just doming a bottle of Grey Goose, you know, in the back, out back by the shitter there. But hey, here we are. And you know, you're thinking, this is pretty alarming. Well, it's sort of repeat behavior, because the same thing happened in 2011 when the World Juniors were in Buffalo and they wouldn't fly. The Team Russian World Juniors got too drunk and they wouldn't let them fly on the plane, so they had to sober up. So kudos to them. We all have our coping mechanisms.
I just go look at how large Russia is, guys. Like, that's another world.
It's okay? Another world.
I think people don't fully, like, maybe it's just me, but people don't look at a world map enough to just see how insanely big Russia is.
It's on two continents.
It's on two continents. So just, you know, they got another world and they got their rules, and it's fine because it's their rules.
And hey, the way she goes, don't get too drunk on an airplane. That's,
yeah, just don't be that person.
Arash, before we get into some other bits, do you have anybody you want to add to the banned list? Anybody, anything? Pucks on that banned list, the old PON banned list, the first submission of 2011. And we kind of talked about 20. Oh, there's a Freudian slip. 2022.
We did, but now I forget because I'm insane. Who was it that we talked about?
Oh, the 2011 Stanley Cup run.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, let's talk. Yeah, we don't need to do that. Oh, let me talk to... Oh, my God. Okay, now I remember. Should we leave it for 5 minutes for pain? Because it's pretty funny.
About what?
About what happened at New Year's Eve.
Sure, yeah. That's a nice little tease. If you want to hear how Arash and myself spent New Year's Eve, 5 minutes or paying will happen immediately after this show, and go check it out. And Grace M, our new Patreon backer, will be able, they'll be able to check it out because they pledged $5 American a month. A couple of other tidbits here before we get into questions, Arash. Tuukka Rask and the Boston Bruins are working out agreement. They're going to be he's going to be playing for them again, which I'm very curious to see how that turns out based on his age and the quality of play out of the old whatever the hell their stupid nickname is, the old Boston Bruins there.
The Bees?
Sure.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I have no... Yeah, okay. Well, you just signed Linus Ulmark to 5x5. And you also have Jeremy Swayman.
Brad Marchand shooting his mouth off that he that the NHL players can't go to the Olympics because it was promised to them in the last CBA, essentially. And I think the NHL is doing you a favor by not sending you over there. I'm just putting that out there.
Yeah, man. I'm trying to envision like Brad Marchand like in a hotel room for 3 to 5 weeks in China, and he's like, oh, and then he has a reflective period, be like, oh man, maybe this whole rat thing isn't a great idea after all. You know. I don't know. I think we should give players the freedom to kind of voice their opinions on... they should absolutely have the platform to... No, wait, sorry. They should have the ability to use their platform in any way. They are not immune to the response and the consequences of using said platform in a specific way. Like, so you can be a Trumper, you can be whatever. Just, you know...
Well, he's not even being a troublemaker.
No.
He's just listen, this is bullshit. And we've wanted for the last 15 years, or ever since Wayne Gretzky retired, was for these players to show some sort of emotion and character, or not character, but like personality. And now he does it. I'm like, well, geez, I don't know.
Isn't it insane that like Connor McDavid is missing two Olympics?
They need a World Cup.
World Cup of Hockey. We absolutely need a World Cup of Hockey.
And I don't necessarily, if you want gimmick teams again,
teams. Like height, like, oh, ooh, that's, okay, wait, I know we have to get into questions quickly.
We from the tall team select Tyler Myers again.
What would be your, you know what, let's leave this to the listeners because we can talk about this next week as well.
Okay.
Guys, please tweet Ryan Geeter or I with your best niche World Cup of Hockey team. Like, we're talking about height, handedness, hair color, lack of hair, who you might think is the best chef, you know, any niche, like, stupid, like, idea that you have, please, we'll read the best ones out. We'll read the best ones out to on the pod next week.
Yeah, Ryan, best niche. We'll clip that. Best niche World Cup team.
Yes.
I like it. But yeah, a World Cup needs to happen. It needs to happen in NHL arenas. It needs to happen in, I hate to sound xenophobic, but North American time zones, because I get it, and that's just me. But it needs to happen in a somewhat controlled environment, and based on the 2018 Olympics, and based on the 2020 Olympics, and based on how Sochi went, it's time. I think the mystique, the bloom is off the rose with NHL players going to the Olympics.
All right,
and a best on best needs to happen.
All right, Seal.
Here's some quick positive news. Canadian Olympic women's hockey silver medalist Bridget Lacouette is hired as a scout by the Chicago Blackhawks, becoming the first Indigenous woman to scout for an NHL team.
Hell and yeah.
Hey, you still got a lot to do, Chicago, but that's a...
Take all those jobs from men. I'm telling you, take them. Take all those white men's jobs. Let's change the culture. Let's go.
Mm-hmm.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
We're coming for you, Ryan.
Arash, I'm going to ask you a
quick
question.
Coming for you, Shap. Don't deflect.
What job do I have?
Job of being beautiful.
I just have the Patreon login.
God damn it. As soon as I get that login, it's over. You'll be going to Mandy being like, Mandy, I need the credit card. I don't have the Patreon money anymore.
Arash, I have a question for you before we go into questions. Who's going to be the next, you have to pick one, who's going to be the next head coach of the Edmonton Oilers, Travis Green or Mike Babcock?
Oh, Mike Babcock.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
You know, and, they're gonna get the 2002 Salt Lake City committee back together again. You know, Kevin Lowe is going to be there being like, I know a couple things about winning. And Wayne's going to be like, I know a couple things about winning. And they're all going to be like, you know who knows a couple things about winning? Mike Babcock.
You know, he won that Stanley Cup once when anybody like coaching that team.
Salt Lake City was 20 years ago, and like the same kind of core people that did that are still like in the Edmonton Oilers organization.
So they all work in Edmonton.
They all work in Edmonton. So it's like, Jesus Christ.
Let's go to some questions here. Roger R. Smith, Cool Indian 101. This is a very good, simple question that I'm curious. Sir. I'd like to hear from you, and I'd like to chime in. When the Canucks hired coach Bruce Boudreaux, did you think they would go on a winning streak, or like me, were you just hoping for a win here or there? And Arash, I'd like you to go first. Oh. What were your honest expectations on January 5th, that beautiful evening, on December 5th, sorry, where they announced that Boudreaux was coming in?
Let's see. I felt like they were, I just from seeing what I saw in like Chicago and everything, I thought, you know, there's going to be kind of this uplifting amount of energy from where I saw Bruce coming in and like having just quick discussions with players. I thought, yeah, you know what? They'll win a couple. They'll figure stuff out, whatever. Mm-hmm. And you know, they won't go on a crazy run. Here they are. They've done it. They had a long break in between their big run, have continued to collect points. If it's the shootout loss or the win a couple of nights ago. I was just kind of baffled. And it just seems like the more and more you kind of look at it, where was it entirely a systems-based thing? Was this just a block that some players had in terms of the kind of coaching that they had, or the you make one mistake and you're stapled kind of idea? Or now they have the freedom to just say, hey, let's like, boys, let's go and let's just have a little bit of fun. And like, they're having fun again. And it really, the one thing that I think really did help, and this is, I believe, huge credit to the Larchsiders, right? The Larchsiders?
The Larchsiders, yeah.
Larchsiders, yeah.
Chanting section.
The Bruce There It Is chant, which I know people are a little like, some people are like rolling their eyes at it, but it brought a level of levity and kind of easiness to the fan base.
It was so lighthearted.
We were just having fun again. And it was almost like this it was like people in the arena were asking permission to have fun again.
Yes.
And by everyone chanting, it's like, oh, okay, we're allowed to have fun again. And then it just kind of went from there.
And for anybody listening that was like, that's stupid, that's immature, that's uncool, laughingstock of the league. If you were dissecting that stupid chant as anything more than just like fans having fun because they were in good moods, you don't get it. And Bruce There It Is not for you. And it's...
Yeah, if you run a Vancouver-based wrestling organization, you might not be a fan of. I'm not going to say who, but...
Could be anybody.
I heard he has a new job right now. Oh, no, he's announcing a new thing. Oh, no, he's a new thing.
To quickly wrap up Roger's question, I expected...
Well, we're going to get tweeted at now, Ryan.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
There goes our mentions. I expected them to win the first two games, and I expected things to kind of hover around 500. But it's like, again, you didn't realize what was broke with the current system, and that fell on the shoulders of a lot of people, not just a head coach, or not just a GM. And I think all like I didn't expect Bruce to go five. I expect him to have a 500 record, but what he has done is just shown that it was broke for a long time and it needed fixing. And thank God they did it. 47 Erica is on Instagram. Simple question: are the Canucks buyers or sellers at the deadline?
I'm gonna say there's a middle, there's an in between at this, where I think they are. This is hard to say. How do I describe this? There's a way to go into the trade deadline where it's not necessarily being like I think they might be sellers, but not in the traditional way that you see teams mm-hmm. being sellers. I think you might see moves that are more lateral based or future thinking, but having a sooner. It's not going to be just like, okay, we're trading core piece for just mm-hmm. a pick. You know, you're going to see more creative moves than your traditional, like a hockey trade type idea.
I wish I had them off the top of my head, but in the last couple of years, you have seen teams sell at the deadline almost and still, you know, make it interesting in the playoffs. So mm-hmm. gone is the mindset of we need to get Keith Tkachuk in here at any cost necessary and it doesn't matter. Like, you know, there's smart moves that could be made at that time that benefit you or benefit a contender or benefit both. And it's about making the best possible move, which could be huge. It could be nothing, but you know, you can't go in with a buyer or seller mindset.
Amen.
Heather Smart, on the Discord, which if you are a Patreon backer pledging $5 or more a month, you get access to. And you know what? If you stop pledging money to Pucks on Net on a Patreon, you lose access. So it's very exclusive on the Discord.
Oh, that's so mean.
It's the way she goes. It's a benefit, baby. Okay, it's an economy. You got to ask these hard questions. It's just like I love anybody that's pledged a dollar, a penny, that's listened to this podcast for 1 minute or every minute or whatever. I appreciate anybody that's taken the time to do this, but these are the things we offer as a perk. And if you really want to stay in the Patreon, in the Discord, we'll talk, but that is the policy. Heather Smart, still number one favorite listener, even though we got those trading cards from Yerky. Unrelated to hockey, do you guys have any movie series you rewatch a lot? Like a comfort TV show, but a movie. Ha, ha, ha.
Oh, yeah.
I think we have the same one.
I mean, I could make an entire podcast about films that I rewatch constantly and TV shows. Well, it's more films. Like, for example, randomly, I watched Amadeus last night. 3-hour movie, Milos Forman, 1984. Delightful film. Amazing. Just, you realize it's great. Yeah, movies. Let's see. Off the top of my head, movies that I rewatch a lot.
Well, I would say yeah. One of mine. Like, if I was to throw off my top three of movies I watch a lot, I think we might have one of the same, which is Moneyball.
Yeah, Moneyball is a comfort. It's such an easy watch. Like, fuck.
It's so easy, and you could turn it on at any time, and just like, oh, it's getting good. Like, mm-hmm. I could turn it in 90 seconds in. Like, okay, it's getting good now. Like, mm-hmm. every part of the movie. It'll hook you. But if I was to rattle off a quick top three, like it's similar to like if it's on cable, I will watch it. Like mm-hmm. I would say that because I have Boomer Cable. Moneyball. I want to say Pulp Fiction and maybe Goodfellas. If Goodfellas is ever on cable, I will watch it at any time in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
But as like a comfort food movie, Bull Durham is like that for me. I love that movie to pieces. And I want to say Step Brothers are super bad or things that I will watch it over and over and over again.
Okay, well, I have, let's see. I'm going to say a couple ones that are going to surprise you. Number one is Jersey Boys.
Okay.
Clint Eastwood. Amazing. I don't know why. I love Frankie Valli. Like, I'm a huge Frankie. Yeah. So when I hear that fucking Beggin' cover on the radio, I just want to kill myself. But like, what's the best what's version of Beggin' is the best? I'm like, get out. Hearing some kid with a hair tie. I mean, my hair is tied backwards, but like, I was like, I'm Beggin'. Back in, you know, it's like, get out. What is that? That's I'm puking over here. There's that. That's really good. The Martian, Ridley Scott.
Okay.
The director's cut, the really long one, is really good because it's like Moneyball, but it's like, man, it's Matt Damon trapped in Mars, on Mars. It's pretty great. It's funny, very light. And, also Heat, Michael Mann's Heat.
Okay.
So, that movie's really good. More of like a guy film, but I think just for films that have totally changed my life.
Arash, you were saying you watch Wild Things with Denise Richards and Nev Campbell a lot. Like, that's a good
movie. Oh, did I?
Yeah.
When did I say that?
No, I'm watching Pen 15, and they had the episode where they all watch Wild Things, and I'm like, I've been there.
You love Pen 15, huh? Was Pen 15, so Pen 15's an American show or a CBC show?
It's American. It's through Hulu, but it's on CBC Gem.
All right, cool. Yeah, good. I should probably start watching it.
Oh, it's great. I can give you my login.
Oh, pal.
I'll owe you one.
I'll owe you one, pal. That's four logins you owe me now.
Richard H., also on the Discord. If it's not too personal, I would love to hear one holiday break wintertime tradition everyone does every year that you really enjoy. And he mentioned his whole family renting a large home on the coast to all get together. And I have been very vocal that I have one long-standing tradition in my family. We are not very traditional in the least bit, but my late Nana, who wasn't the nicest woman, but she did know how to make a stiff drink, she brought the Brandy Alexander to the family, which is brandy, cream de cacao, and a half and half, which we've later upgraded to an oat milk with ice, bit of a slurpy flavor. Absolutely love it. Love bringing out at Christmas, and really lightens the mood and really brings the old Chap family together. But I am a big fan of that. And I've recently, like before parties were illegal, I brought the blender and everything to make them for friends this year. And they're a big hit. And that's my one really family tradition that I will beat into the ground, and I'm championing. So that's mine.
Family tradition. I think the most memorable family thing for us is specifically just like watching Home Alone 2 with my mom every year. Like, we love Home Alone 2 just because we both love New York, and we grew up kind of idolizing. Always, like, we went on a New York trip together. It was fucking great.
Really?
Yeah, it was great. Oh, 2014, I think, we went to New York, had a great time. And I also went to, like, London with my mom because my mom...
Did you get lost?
No, thank God I did not get lost. And was it Tim Curry didn't come around chasing me being like, oh, Kevin McAllister, here's your stretched limousine and a pizza.
That didn't happen to you, strange.
That did not happen to me. But that's, I have a really weird tradition for Christmas that not everyone gets, but I rewatch the Rangers and Philadelphia Winter Classic series.
That's so good.
It's just like, it's I don't know what it is, but it's such a Christmas vibe, and it's so well done, and it just gets me, I don't know, it just triggers something in my brain that just gets me to
at least two episodes, or maybe at least one, is around the Christmas time, and it talks about what these, so it's
Marion Gabbert getting a tree, and he's like hauling a tree around.
I've rewatched both of those a fair bit. I couldn't tell you if I love the first or second season more. Both are just absolutely tremendous. And we learned a lot about our Gabby, about his quirks through that first one.
He loves the Haagen-Dazs at what, 9 a.m.?
It's not even 10 a.m. yet. All right, whatever.
Hell yeah, Gabby, go.
Yeah, I definitely some of my formative early, you know, more significant or memorable early 20s years around Christmas definitely were watching HBO 24/7. So that really hits home, and I might need to start stealing that one.
Yeah.
Finally, Lauren Gardner, that guy 72 on Twitter. This is a Simpsons reference. Could Jesus microwave a burrito so hot that he himself could not eat it?
I know exactly what clip that is.
Yeah, he sent the video. I had to get the quote.
Oh, Ned. Well, hey, Homer.
I would argue no, because Jesus was still just a regular man. I don't think he had some sort of bionic stomach.
Wait, no, the answer is yes.
Hmm.
Could, wait. Is the God question, could Jesus microwave a burrito so hot that he could not eat it?
Oh, yes. Sorry, I phrased that wrong. Yes, any
yeah,
hot
okay,
burrito.
So, Ryan, so if the idea that Jesus was a man, are you, Jesus could put a burrito in a microwave for like 10 minutes, and as a man, there's no way you can eat it because you'd scald yourself.
Yeah.
So or the burrito would, actually, this is what is interesting. The burrito would probably explode. Because you have to microwave it.
And then you got
to
eat the microwave.
Because... And what is so hot? Like, could you just put the burrito in the microwave for 10 minutes and then it just kind of, it would just blow up in the microwave. And then what is Jesus supposed to do? Take a little scooper and just like, and then he'd scald his tongue as well. So not only does he have a scalded tongue, his microwave is full of burrito gunk.
Boy, this Jesus is really getting a lot of punishment, man. It's really out of character for him.
We got to really have a hard discussion about who... our top deities are and where okay. Right. Ryan, we've been doing this for an hour and a half, pal.
Yeah, I'll wrap up the first podcast of 2022. Once again, I want to thank everybody for listening. I appreciate Gita. She'll be back next week. Trust me, she did not put in the paperwork or the Pucks on Net vacation approval for the second episode of 2022. So she'll be back. Rash will be here. I'll be here.
Oh, we'll be. Gita's going to be pulling extra time.
She's going to have a J Fresh cork board up. She's going to be explaining. There's going to be some sort of string details. But we want to thank everybody for listening once again. Follow us on Twitter, PucksNetCA or PucksNetCA. Buy the naming rights of the CA. That's 10 bucks a month to do it. And you get to put your little message, your little greeting in there afterwards. And you buy those rights by supporting us on Patreon, patreon.com/pucks.net. Pledge a couple of bucks.
Couple of difficult discussions.
Difficult discussions. I think Gray Sam had a difficult discussion at midnight saying, how am I gonna achieve my New Year's resolution?
12:04. Bam!
Let me just tell you this. I had a New Year's resolution back in 2017. It was to buy a t-shirt from the number 5 Orange. Gita, myself, and Errol, we went there. We watched the gold medal game of the World Juniors. I got my shirt. Boom. January 4th, it was done. Support the show on Patreon. Help us out. And if you don't want to support us, you don't want to give us your money, perfectly fine. Christmas just happened. It's an expensive time of year, so if you want to help us out, a little freebie. Spotify just introduced ratings for podcasts. Go give us a 5-star rating. If you're still on the old Steve Jobs machine, give us a 5-star rating and a positive review on Apple Podcasts. Go share the podcast in your Instagram stories. Go to YouTube, where we put clips out every week up there. Go just interact and tell a friend, help out however you can, and that's going to help us out immensely. But if you do, patreon.com/pucksonnet, pledge a couple of bucks. We're going to go into 5 minutes for paying. We had a tease earlier, what we're going to talk about. It's a little New Year's Eve, a little Christmas time. So we'll see you then, and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Bruce, there it is.
Bruce, there it is.
Bruce,
Bruce, there it is. Oh, you got to love it.